My prayer is that you will know, that you will press on to know the supremacy of Christ, the supremacy of his deity, equal with God the Father in all of his attributes, the radiance of his glory and the exact image of his nature, the supremacy of his eternality that makes the mind want to explode with the imponderable thought that Jesus Christ never had a beginning. He is simply there, absolute reality with which we reckon. We must rise to the supremacy of his eternality, while all the universe, including this building and your body and this earth and all the galaxies, are fragile, contingent, like a shadow in comparison to the substance of Jesus Christ. We must know the supremacy of his never-changing constancy. Oh, to have virtues that never change, a character whose commitment is constant, yesterday, today, and forever. Let us know the supremacy of his constancy. And let us know the supremacy of his knowledge that makes the Library of Congress look like a matchbox and makes all the information on the internet look like a 1940s farmer's almanac, and makes all of quantum physics and everything that Stephen Hawking has ever dreamed look like a first grade reader. We must know the supremacy of the knowledge of our Lord. We must know the supremacy of his wisdom that has never been perplexed by any problem whatsoever, nor can he be counseled by any person or any being in the universe. We must know the supremacy of his authority. All authority is mine in heaven and on earth and under the earth. No change. All authority. Changing times and seasons, removing kings, setting up kings, doing according to his will in the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. No one can stay his hand or say to him, "What have you done?" We must know the supremacy of his providence, without which not a single bird in the extended reaches of the Amazon forest has ever fallen off of any limb, and without which not one hair turns white or black. We must know the providence of Jesus. We must know the supremacy of his word, which upholds the universe by the word of his power. All the galaxies, molecules, atoms, and subatomic reality nobody has yet dreamed of, down there where no one has yet looked. We must know the supremacy of his power to walk on water and cleanse lepers and heal the lame and open the eyes of the blind and open the ears of the deaf and cause storms to cease and with two words to raise the dead. Lazarus, come forth, or one word to raise the dead. In your blood, I said to you, live. We must know the supremacy of his power. We must know the supremacy of his purity. He never sinned. He never sinned. He never had one millisecond of a bad attitude or a sinful lust. We must know the supremacy of his trustworthiness. He never breaks a promise. He always keeps his word, absolutely without fail. We must know the supremacy of his justice. He will render all accounts settled in the end, in the universe, either on the cross or in hell. No injustice will remain when Christ is finished with his supreme justice. We must know the supremacy of His patience. He has endured you and me for decades. He has endured this city and brings the sun. Can you imagine why the sun rose on this city this morning, this wicked city, this world so full of us-type sinners, and He makes paradise rise in the sky in Minneapolis? What kind of patience are we dealing with here? We must know the supremacy of His servant-like sovereign obedience, kept every one of His Father's commands absolutely, and in the end embraced the cross with total willingness. We must know the supremacy of His meekness and lowliness and tenderness. He will not break a bruised reed or quench a smoldering flax. We must know the supremacy of His wrath. One day it will explode on this world from heaven, such that all who have rejected Him will call for rocks to crush their brain, lest they have to face the wrath of the Lamb. We must know this. When I look at the beheadings and I hear someone ask, "Where is your Supreme Christ?" my answer is really easy. He is in heaven storing up almighty wrath in fury to pour out on all those who commit such sins. That's where He is. And you better get right with Him and repent, or you will all likewise perish. It's not a hard question to answer biblically. We must know the supremacy of His grace, which gives to the spiritually dead rebels like us life, wakens faith in hell-bound haters of God, justifies the ungodly with His own righteousness. We must know the supremacy of His love, which dies for us while we are yet sinners and gives to the absolutely undeserving the ability for ever-increasing joy in making much of Him. And we must know the supremacy of His gladness. In the fellowship of the Trinity, infinite power, infinite energy, infinite joy rising, spilling over in the creation of a universe and becoming for you one day an inheritance for every struggling saint. We must know this is what we were made for. Press on to know the Lord. We are made to know Christ. We're not made to do little diddly things. We're made to know this massive Christ. This world is little two-second slice, and then with Him or not, forever. It's what we are created to know and do and be about. And when we know Him in those ways, we have begun to know the outskirts of His supremacy. Would fail to speak of His supreme severity and invincibility and dignity and simplicity and complexity and resoluteness and calmness and depth and courage. If there is anything admirable, if there is anything worthy of praise in all the universe, it is summed up in Jesus Christ.